Hey everybody, how you doing? IntoWeapons back again with you. It's that time of year again where I take all my AKs out of the safe and kind of give you guys a run through of my collection. This has been a little over a year since my last video that I've done on this, and it's grown quite substantially with the number of rifles that I've had in the collection. Kind of plateaued over the last 3 or 4 months, mainly because I ran out of space to store these guys, and unless I get another safe, the wife really isn't allowing me to have any more guns. So this is kind of where I'm at for 2014. Again, I just wanted to run through these guns real quickly. What I'll probably do is, as I'm showing you the gun, maybe link towards the bottom an annotation for one for an overview of the gun if you're interested in learning more details. And then over maybe to the right, I'll do another annotation for, you know, some firing range footage if you guys are interested in checking some of these guys out at the firing range. As many of you know, I'm really into big muzzle flashes, and a lot of my videos that I have for these kind of show that or highlight that from these guns. So if you're interested, go ahead and check that out. Otherwise, what I'll probably do is just kind of start from left to right. And as many of you know, my videos are unscripted. I don't really edit them. I don't, you know, put out my bloopers, that kind of thing. So forgive me if I make a mistake, and certainly go ahead and feel free to leave a note down in the description if you guys feel like I missed an important feature of the rifle, or maybe I did make a mistake on a feature of the rifle. You know, feel free to put it down there. I'm not an expert, guys. I just really enjoy collecting rifles, and I just kind of want to share that with you. So really don't hold me to high expert standards, because I'm definitely not an expert. But what I generally like to do is kind of start with a couple guns that are not considered AK-47s or patterned after the AK-47 rifle, but really kind of share a common history. And I know my 2013 video, a lot of people gave me heck for calling them, relatives of the AK-47 or distant cousins, that kind of thing. So really just want to say these two rifles kind of just share a common history with, you know, the Russians and the AK-47. So to start that off with, we'll go ahead and pull out the Norinco SKS, and this came out prior to the AK-47, and many people are familiar with this rifle. This is a Chinese variant, so it's a little bit more common on the US market. There's a lot of these available. They run around $300 right now. 10 round box magazine, as you can see there. But it's a nice rifle. They're very durable, reliable. This is a pretty good example of what they can look like. Many of them you'll see are beat up. Another common variant out there are from the Yugos, the Yugo AK variant, or I'm sorry, Yugo SKS variant. But this one's all numbers matching. Like I said, a pretty good example. Found this at a gun store a while back and shot it a few times. Had a couple slam fire issues with it, which isn't uncommon for these types of rifles. As you can see, it does have the fold-out spike bayonet. It's pretty common for these rifles. Sticks up there like that. And I like SKSs. I prefer the AK-47 over them. I know a lot of people prefer SKSs over the AK-47. So, again, a very popular rifle on the U.S. market. Not an AK-47 pattern, but, you know, again, very close history to the AK-47 type rifle. So that's the first one that I was going to start out with. Another one that is very similar to the AK-47. And the reason I say that is because it was designed after the AK-47 by the Czechoslovakians. And the reason that they designed this, which is the VZ-58 copy, this one's a VZ-2008 by Century Arms, they really didn't like using the Russian designs. They kind of had an issue with those guys, so they kind of came up with their own little design. And depending on who you talk to, a lot of people will say this is a superior firearm to the AK-47. It is lighter. It does have a kind of almost a similar operation to the SKS. But it looks very similar to an AK-47, as you can see here. Solid rifle. I really like this rifle a lot. I, as you can see, replaced the folding side stock here, which normally comes with it, with a fixed stock. And this is a wood impregnated with plastic. A lot of people refer to it as beaver barf. A lot of people kind of confuse it with Bakelite. It's kind of got that color, but as you can see, the grain on that is different, obviously, than what you'll find on a Bakelite. Overall, pretty solid rifle. Again, Century makes these. Right now they're pretty cheap. They run about $359, $400, and you get a whole bunch of accessories with them. So, pretty solid rifle. I enjoy shooting it. I haven't really actually had it out to the range since I put on the fixed stock, so I'll have to get it out to the range and do a little bit more test firing with it, see how I like that. But again, a rifle that is not an AK-47, but shows has a similar history to that of the AK-47. So what we'll do is we'll kind of start towards, I think, maybe the top and work our way from left to right and show you what I got here. I kind of grouped them together as best as possible. Towards the left top here, we have some Arsenal products. To the right of the VZ and the SKS, we have some Zastava products, which are Yugo design. Down here to the left, On the bottom row, we have a US-made over here, Century, C39. And then we go into some of the Russian firearms. We have a German 22. We have the Romanian section after that. So we'll go through each one of these individually and kind of show you what we have and just an overview of them. Again, real quick, not going into all the features of these, but we'll start off with the Arsenal products. And if you're not familiar with Arsenal, these are some of the top of the line AKs that you can buy on the market, the US market. Very solid built. These are from Bulgaria, from the Circle 10 factory. Arsenal makes them. Solid rifles. This is a SLR-101S, and it is a milled receiver, as you can identify by this lightning cut into the receiver. This isn't a stamped receiver like most AKs you'll find on the market. They actually CNC these out, machine these out from a solid piece of metal. And like I said, these are the top of the line AKs that you can find. Very expensive, run you $1,000 plus, typically around the $1,200, $1,300 range, if you can find them. A lot of these are limited production, or what I should say Arsenal says is limited production. A lot of times they have runs and then they come back out with more runs later on, and it's kind of a marketing scheme for them. But everything, the fit and finish, is awesome. There isn't really anything bad you can say about these. It does come with the bayonet lug on there, standard. The threaded barrel, as you can see there, you can take off the muzzle brakes and put different muzzle brakes on. Has the cleaning rod, which a lot of people like to see. Comes with some really nice polymer furniture. And this one has the heat shield on the bottom, which does actually help quite a bit with mitigating heat as you're shooting rapid fire, a lot of shots after one another. Again, that bolt carrier is like glass when you're pulling this back, the action of this gun. There's no hang-ups at all, just really smooth, nice action. The triggers aren't the best. Arsenal isn't known for the best triggers, but they do. You can certainly swap those out if you need to. But overall, real nice gun. It's probably one of the finer rifles in the collection that I have. Another Arsenal that we have here is the SLR-106FR. And this is chambered in 223-556. And this again was a limited production. In fact, I think Arsenal stopped making these in this chamber. It has the, again, screw-off muzzle brake there, AK-74 style flash hider. It's got a bayonet lug as well as a, you know, accessory lug on there, cleaning rod. It's got the same furniture on there with the heat shield. This one is a stamped model, so it doesn't, it's not machined, it is stamped out. But it does have, again, exceptional fit and finish. This one does have the folding stock on there, which is real nice. The operation of it is just over here on this other side. There's a button that you push, and it folds this over, as you can see, like that, and folds into the side of the gun real nice, clicks into spot so it's locked in, and then on the end of the buttstock here is a button. You can fold it back out. The recoil impulse on this gun is phenomenal. It's very similar to an AR-15. So with the projectile and the ballistics and everything, it's just very easy to handle this rifle. As you can see, it's got a side rail scope mount for all those accessories that you want. And that's pretty much it. It's just a nice standard AK-101 by Arsenal. Again, more of a collector because they say they aren't going to make them anymore, but you really never know with Arsenal. So moving on, the last Arsenal product that we have is the pistol version of the rifle we just looked at. This is the SLR-106UR. And this is actually the SLR-10658 model, just because of the muzzle brake that you see on there. It's an in-house one by Arsenal. And the muzzle flash and signature on this thing is horrendous. It's crazy. It's super fun. It's really a head ringer, and I would highly recommend checking out the annotation here to see some of the range footage on this, or even going out to my channel. I got a bunch of videos out there of this thing going off, and it's just a lot of fun to shoot this thing. Again, limited production. You really can't find these guys. There's a couple different variants. One has a crank-off type brake. This one, again, has that in-house brake. Run you about $900 to $1,000, which is insane for an AK pistol, but chambered in 223-556. The recoil is very easy to handle. It's got a side rail scope mount, although I don't really know why you would use that unless maybe you'd put a red dot on there. It's got the crank-off style sights on there, if I can maybe get that in there. I don't know. There you go. And overall, super cool gun to have, to fire. It's a lot of fun. My wife enjoys shooting this. Much easier to shoot than a 7.62x39 pistol. The recoil is just much more manageable. But it has much, much heavier of a bark. So very cool pistol, one of my favorites in the collection. From that point, what we're going to do is move into the Zastava stuff. And the first one we have here is a M70AB2 folding AK, 7.62x39. And this one has got the actual thicker receiver on there, RPK type receiver, 1.5 millimeter thick, stamped receiver, just a little bit thicker than standard. Has the RPK style receiver with these exposed areas up here in the front trunnion, as you can see. It's an underfolder, as you can see there, it's got the button. It's a little bit tight, I barely shoot this thing, but it does fold up and under like this. And a lot of people really like these for truck guns, because they do get really compact. They're super durable. You could probably throw this off a bridge, pick it up and still shoot it, not a big deal. But made in Serbia at the Zastava factory. It's a Yugo design. It's got the grenade shut off here and sights. And what it does is when you attach the grenade launching spigot to the end here, it is threaded obviously, you'll actually be able to launch grenades out of it. It'll just turn it into a single shot. You put a blank adapter and a blank 7.62x39 cartridge in there with the spigot, and you get yourself a little grenade launcher. So that's pretty cool. It does have the night sights on here, which are pretty interesting. A lot of AK variants don't actually have that, but as you can see, it flips up to some night sights, and there's some tritium vials in there that will glow for its expected lifespan, that radioactive tritium. The front sights have that as well. And that's one of the features of the Yugo rifles, are these flip-up night sights. You really don't see that too often anywhere else. But overall, super solid rifle. These are actually very reasonable in cost. They run you about $500 to $600 max. But be careful, there is two models out there. The M70AB2T, which is a flat side receiver that is not thicker by any means, and it's not an RPK style receiver. You'll be able to tell because this will be missing on it. And that's fine, no big deal. It certainly will operate just as well. But just to be aware that there is two different models out there. And I believe these are built off parts guns. Sentry builds them off kits that are brought into the country. So these are actually used military-issued kits that have been rebuilt. Moving along in the Serbian family, we have the Zastava OPAP. And this is a really cool rifle. Again, it has the thicker RPK type receiver with the 1.5 millimeter thick receiver there, walls. Makes it a little bit more durable. This one is the OPAP variant, which is a little bit more collectible. They didn't import a whole lot of these. What's more prevalent is the NPAP, and we'll get into that next. It has a cleaning rod, no bayonet lug. It has the original wood furniture on there, which had a lot of dings and stuff on there. Just kind of cleaned it up and protected it. Gives it a lot of character. But overall, just a super solid rifle. The stock on this one is a little bit more collectible because it has the Serbian crest on there, the kind of a chicken thing. Some people like it, some people don't. A lot of the rifles did not come into the country with those. There is a dispute out there whether Sentry put those on there or, you know, Zastava did. No one can really tell for sure. So that's up for debate. But overall, if you can grab one of these rifles, they should run you. Retail, typically you'll find them between $550 and $600. On the collector market, since a lot of people realize that they're not coming into the market and they're becoming harder to find, you might find them upwards of $700 to $800 even. But very solid rifle. A lot of cool features on there, like the side rail scope mount, the thicker receiver, the wood furniture, and threaded muzzle, cleaning rod, sling mounts. And again, this one, the OPAPs come into the country, and they do not have typically the night sights on there, but you can add them because it does have the cutouts to add them back on there, which I did after the fact. I have a video out there on how I did that. But I replaced the night sights, ordered some night sights and some tritium vials, replaced the rear one there, as well as the front one. So you can see it's a flip up, flip down, just like the M70AB2. And those are pretty simple to do. Brings a little bit more authenticity back to the rifle. So moving on from there, we'll kind of get into a pistol. And I typically say this next to the OPAP just because it reminds me a lot of the OPAP, even though it's probably closer to the NPAP. But this is the M92 Serbian Zastava AK pistol. more of a crink-off type design. I haven't done anything with the barrel or the muzzle. It is a different size muzzle thread on there, 26 millimeters, I think, or something like that. You can get the crink-off type brakes on there. The boosters is what they call them. But real short gas system. It's got the Yugo type hand designs, which are a little bit more easily identifiable compared to a lot of the other AK handguards out there. It's got the flat side, 1 millimeter thick receiver. It does have a bolt hold open in the safety, which I notice a lot of the MPAPs and stuff are coming to the country now with, which is nice. You can lock it back there, the bolt. Crink off type sights. And then on the other side, we have no side rail scope mount. It does have the pinhole designation there for the fun lever. And overall, real fun pistol. Just a standard AK pistol. Really nothing super exciting about it. A lot of people have these because they're very reasonable. You can find these close to $350, $400, maybe $450 if you're having a hard time finding one. But very reasonable in cost. A lot of people are adding the SB47 to these and making it a loophole short barrel rifle. But overall, these guns will run and run all day long. Quality built. Nothing really beats the Zastava factory products. They're pretty much top of the line, you know, for its cost range. So definitely a solid gun. Highly recommend checking them out if you're interested in an AK pistol. The last one that we have for the Zastava is the NPAP. And this is super common on the market right now. A lot of people have these. I bought this way back in 2012 and overpaid a little bit on it. I think I paid close to $650, $700 or something like that. And the market on these have drastically changed. I think these have come down close to $450, $500. And for that price range, this is a phenomenal rifle. It comes with finished handguards. It is a standard stamped receiver. As you can see, it's got the bolt hold open. All the internals and bolt carrier and bolt are all supreme products from, you know, the Zastava factory. Beautiful stock on there, again, finished product. Over on the other side, take a look at that. We have the side rail scope mount, which is real nice. You can put all your optics on there that you want. It's got a saw grip type thing with the ergo fingers in there you can use. It's a little bit nicer than some of the standard M70s. This one does not come with the cutouts for the night sights on the rear sight or the front sight post. So if you're looking to do that, you would have to stick with the OPAP or have some of those things switched out. The rear sight wouldn't be difficult to switch out, but the front sight would be a little bit more difficult. You'd have to knock off that front sight post from the barrel and move your way off it and put a new one on. But it's got a cleaning rod, sling attachment. Again, very solid rifle. A lot of people complain about the cheek slap on these. It does hurt if you're not familiar with how to, you know, handle a rifle like this specifically because of this comb right here in the stock. It does pound the heck out of your cheek. There's no doubt about that. But for the price point, this is a very solid rifle. One thing I will note is it does not come with a bayonet lug. I actually had one installed by a gunsmith, ran me, I think, $60 or $70 just to have the ears on the lug there put back, or the nut there put back on. So I just had it matched up to a standard Yugo bayonet, and now I can have a bayonet on here for whatever reason I want. It doesn't really happen, but nice to have. Again, brings back more of the authenticity of the rifle. But solid rifle for the price range, you really can't beat it. That's it for the top level, guys. What we'll do is now move down to the bottom level. Hopefully you're sticking with me. My voice is kind of going. I usually don't talk this long in a row. And again, this is an unedited video, so I'm just kind of trying to get through everything all at once. Hopefully I'm not missing too many features, though. I always watch this back later on and say, damn, I should have said something like that, or should have told them about that, and, you know, such is life, unless I script this thing out, which takes forever. So on the bottom line, the bottom row, we're going to start the left hand and work our way to the right. The first one we have here is the Century Arms C39 rifle, and this is a milled variant that they're producing in-house, 100% U.S. made, with wood grips, very nice wood grips. Wood buttstock on there. You can get them in three different things, blonde, brown, or black. This is the brown, classic brown. Really nice rifle. They have very high tolerances, real thick barrel. They have their chevron brake on there, which is in-house, threaded barrel. They have pretty good finish on here. As you can see, again, it's a milled receiver with the lightning cut in there, just to kind of lighten up the rifle a little bit, give it some rigidity. And some debate whether the safety selector here or the dust cover is US made, but that really makes no difference, I guess. It does have some pretty nice RPK style type night sight, or rear sights, I should say. Sorry about that. And those allow you to change for elevation, and I think left and right, and up and down, all that good stuff. So, kind of a neat feature over on this side, just pretty straightforward. It's got the, you can get that in the light there, the big American flag on there, made in USA. Overall, real impressed with this rifle. It's got some really high tolerances. You can tell they put a lot of work into this. When I disassemble it, everything is just super tight, well built, put together. And I think they got a real winner here. And these typically run you between $500-$600, sometimes maybe as high as $700, depending on who you're buying it from. But for the price range on a milled receiver, you really can't beat that, especially being U.S. made. From that point, we're going to get into the Russian rifles. The first one we have here is my Veper 7.62x54R. This is at the Malat factory in Russia. And as many of you know, this is one of my favorite rifles in the collection. I put a ton of money and time into this rifle, and it started off as an $1,100 base rifle, Veper rifle, 16-inch, actually 16.5-inch barrel, 7.62x54R. Really bought it just because it's got a tremendous muzzle flash. Ended up putting close to $1,000, maybe $1,200 worth of accessories on it. And I don't have everything here, such as the scope and the bipod and everything like that. I kind of kept it base simple for you, but as you can see, I got a lot of cool things on there, like the stock and the bone steel folding stock there. Got a different grip on there. It's got the side rail scope mount. It's got the thick RPK style type receiver, which is obviously probably necessary for the 7.62x54R cartridge. I got the CSS forearm on there, Carolina Shooter Supply, which worked out pretty well. I got a video out on all these upgrades, so if you're interested in checking those out. Got an angle foregrip on there. It's really not built for accuracy so much as just having fun, making a lot of noise. Super fun gun to shoot. I got a lot of cool video footage of this thing going off, some mag dumps, things of that nature, so feel free to check that out on my channel. Super fun gun to shoot though. If you get the chance, I would highly recommend buying any Veper product you can at one point. Especially now with the Russian ban going on, these things are going to go up in price significantly, unless it's ever lifted, which is pretty unlikely, you know, considering the Chinese ban never did as well. That was supposed to be temporary. The next one here we have is, and I bought this because of that ban, actually speaking of, this is the Russian SAG IZ-132. And this is newer to my collection. I've only shot it a couple times. Standard 7.62x39. Unconverted, so this is the sporter configuration. As you can see, it doesn't have a pistol grip on there. Standard hunting stock, just kind of a polymer thing, real light and chintzy. And then as you can see, the front isn't really... it doesn't allow for a standard AK-47 grip set to be on here. That's another part of the conversion that you actually have to do. There's no threaded muzzle on there, so you'd have to take care of that. You could add a bayonet lug if you wanted at the same time, maybe. You can take off that front sight post. But real standard rifle. You could buy these all day long, $300-$400 prior to that ban. And now these guys are running upwards of $700. And really what you're paying for is the fact that on the side here it says made in Russia by Izmash. That's what you're paying for. Authentic Russian rifle from the manufacturer, the factory that everyone wants them from. So again, super cheap rifle that has gone exploded in value. A lot of people love these guns because they make great project guns, converting them yourself. I haven't gotten a chance to even look into that yet. The next one's halfway converted, and this is actually from the Izmash factory as well. This is a SAG 12 shotgun, 12 gauge obviously, and the rear part has been converted to a pistol grip. I purchased it like that. I purchased it actually when the market was down on these, and it still ran me at close to $850. So these are pretty expensive rifles. I don't remember exactly how long the barrel is. I want to say it's 16 inches, but I could be wrong. It's got the threaded barrel on there, smooth bore, chrome lined. It's got an accessories rail. You can buy all the box magazines and drum magazines that you want for this guy. Again, made in Russia by Izmash. That's what makes this guy more expensive now at this point. I've seen people selling these on Gumbroker recently since the ban went into effect, close to $1,300-$1,400, sometimes even $1,900, which is insane. But this one will probably stay with me. I always intended for this to be a project gun. Do a lot of accessorizing, kind of like the Veper, and turn it into something really fun. But just really never got around to doing that. But super fun gun to run, super fun gun to take to the range. My buddy has a Veper 12 that we like to shoot together. And I tell you, after shooting the Vepr 12, it's a fabulous rifle. But this Saiga will hold up with it any day of the week. I'm really surprised. It doesn't have as many bells and whistles as that one, but solid shooter, very durable gun. The next one we have here is more for the kiddies. I bought this as a rifle for my daughter when she first started training with an AK sometime in the future. And this is a GSG AK and 22 long rifle. And it's a German sports guns, I believe is what it stands for. And just a real good 22 long rifle that's modeled after the AK-47. And I was actually very impressed. It comes with wood handguards, wood pistol grip, wood stock, and I finished all those up, sealed them up, protected them, made it look real nice. But the build on this gun is actually very impressive. I think I paid $269 or something like that, plus shipping and, the background check, all that good stuff, transfer fees. Right under $300 or so. But for the price, you really can't beat it. This is a pretty solid rifle. I was very impressed. Pretty darn accurate. Easy to shoot, very lightweight, but still very well built. The receiver isn't some flimsy thing. To take it apart is a little bit more challenging compared to a standard AK-47. But still, a fun little plinker gun. I don't mind taking this to the range, and like I said, when you want to train for a fraction of the cost on the platform of your choice, having something in a 22 long rifle variant is very helpful. That is definitely helpful. It'll allow you to become more efficient with the firearm of your choice and still save you a lot of money. From there, we're going to get into the Romanian guns, and that's going to be the remainder of the collection. We have a few of them here. The first one we'll start off with is the Mini Draco. I recently purchased this. These are pretty fun little guns. They run you about $500. And you can get them from a number of retailers. They're coming from Century Arms International. Very short barrel. I want to say it's like 8.5 inches or something like that. Pretty short. It's got a short little nubby gas system in here, which is kind of cute. And overall, super fun gun. A lot of people, again, are using the SB47 brace on here. Make it a loophole short barrel rifle. And compared to the regular Draco, the full size, which we'll look at here in a minute, this is actually a little bit easier to handle. You'd be surprised. You think, with a round like 7.62x39, something smaller would be more difficult to handle, but it actually is very pleasant to shoot, not very difficult at all. It's obviously made in Romania at the Cugir factory. I think it comes in as a parts kit. Maybe actually because it's a pistol, it may come in like this. I'm not 100% sure, but they do a pretty good job of the build on this. I put numerous rounds through it and haven't had any malfunctions. Came with some rough woodage on there. I just finished, put a stain on there and finished up real quickly. Nothing super phenomenal on there, just to more or less protect it. It does come with a threaded muzzle. You can put any muzzle brake you want on there. It comes with a birdcage A2 style type from Century. I decided to opt in for a slant brake, Tapco. Because it is a pistol, you don't have any or 922R compliance issues, which is real nice. You can do whatever you want to this gun and still be within legal compliance. So that's a real cool gun. It's got the Bakelite grip on there, as you can see. Moving up to its big brother is the full-size Draco, and this is one of the first AKs I've ever bought. And I put a few accessories on this as well. Kind of got happy with the plastic when I bought this gun. It was newer to the AK collection world, and just had a little bit of fun with this gun. But again, made in Romania at the Cugir factory. A lot of custom upgrades onto this. At the time, I paid $400 for the Draco. This is the Draco C, so it's got I think it's an underfolder trunnion in the back here. I never converted it, obviously, to SBR. As you can see, I put a sling attachment on the back here, so I can just sling it up. But got the 8-cars rail on the top there, so I can do some optics on there, a red dot, whatever the case may be. I think it's got an 11.5-inch barrel, so a little bit bigger than the Mini Draco, obviously. But another really fun gun now to shoot. My wife enjoys shooting this. It's very easy to handle. It's got a big bark. Just more of a fun novelty gun, unless you, again, put an SB47 or turn it into a short barrel rifle and make it a usable type firearm. The sling can make it usable. Although, as far as functionality with a sling, that's bare to be argued, I guess. So that's kind of the Dracos. This is an actual operating firearm, but I was going to show it to you nonetheless because it is an AK-47. It is considered a firearm. I had to have this legally transferred in through an FFL. But this is a Wasser 10 cutaway rifle made in Romania, used for educating troops on the operation of it. When I got it, it looked like a standard Wasser 10 rifle in very rough shape. I cleaned it up. As you can see, I finished the the stock and the wood handguards, made everything look real nice, cleaned up the metal parts real nice. On the other side here, it doesn't have any cutouts. It's got a side rail scope mount on there. Highlighted all the markers, or all the markings in China marker, which was the first time I ever did that. But as you can see, it's been imported. It's got a serial number. It's got all the designations on there. From this side, you'd probably never be able to tell it was a non-operating firearm. There are another number of safety things in this firearm that make it non-operational. I'm not going to really go into it. I have a separate video out there if you're interested in learning a little bit more about it. But as you can see beyond finishing the wood, what I did do is go in there and you can see the fire control group is shiny. I actually polished all those surfaces so they were a lot easier to see. And this firearm, if I took the magazine out, I got some fake ammo in there. You can function this firearm, pull the carrier back and the trigger group and pull the trigger and everything will operate. Which is a real cool way of demonstrating again how that AK-47 or the AK-47 rifle operates. Just a real cool hanger, wall hanger, that's really what I use it for, conversational piece. Found this and got a pretty good deal on it. It was only, well, I guess if you're a firearm collector, it was a good deal. Found it for $390 or something like that. And I probably wouldn't pay much more than that for a toy, more or less, or a model. But in the collector world, should be worth some money. So I don't really see too many of these available anywhere. Right along the lines of that rifle is a Wasser 1063, and this one again is heavily customized, and this was my most recent project. A lot of you are familiar with this one. It's got a lot of upgrades on there from its base model. This one was my home defense type rifle. If I ever, you know, got into a shit hit the fan type situation, this is the rifle I'm pulling out of the safe and going to war with. But a lot of upgrades on there. Got the Burris fast fire, red dot, which is real lightweight. That was kind of my idea with this rifle, is just keep it super lightweight. Got the Midwest Industries rail on there, Midwest Industries brake. As you know, the Wasser 1063s come with a standard chrome line barrel. They got the bayonet lugs, so they pretty much got all the bells and whistles. Really, it's the bottom of the line for rifles as far as cost, but really don't play into the fact of, you know, its reliability or durability. This thing will run all day long and have no problems. So, got the Krebs custom enhanced safety selector on there with the bolt hold open and finger release and everything. That's real nice. The Galil style bone steel arms, that's what I'm looking for, folding stock on there, which is an awesome product, very solid, durable, well built. Over on the side, on this side, again, just kind of giving you an overview there of side rail scope mounts, angle foregrip, and Midwest Industries rail and brake, and that's pretty much it for this rifle. It's probably with the accessories on it, probably got about $800 total into this rifle. The accessories really will cost you a lot, especially at Burris fast fire. I do also have the Mepro light night sights on here, again with those tritium vials. These aren't flip up, they're just standard sights like that, but real nice sights. The back one lights up with the tritium vials, as well as the front dot there, as you can see, has a tritium vial in there. So again, set up for my home defense type rifle. The next rifle that we're going to look at again goes back to the 7.62x54R cartridge, and this one is a FPK Druganov by TGI, and it's technically just a PSL-54C just because it was built by a different company and has a different designation. But again, we'll just refer to it as the PSL-54C because that's what most people are familiar with. It's got a pencil thin barrel, which marks it as kind of a designated marksman rifle, a DMR, not so much a sniper rifle because of the fact that it'll heat up and your groupings will kind of stray. And I have some videos up that are already kind of proving that, how those groupings will open up on you after a number of rounds. But this one has the Rhineland Arms stock set on there, the Tiger Maple, which is a little bit different from its original. And we'll go ahead and the next rifle I'll show you will be the original configuration to this rifle. But super fun rifle to shoot. Take it out to the range. As you can see, I got the original scope on there. It's got the thick RPK style type receiver to handle that 7.62x54R cartridge. And again, the Rhineland Arms stock set on here with the cheek riser, sling attachments, and all that fun stuff. The cheek riser is adjustable. The stock set came out pretty well. I had a professional company actually finish it for me. I wasn't really prepared to lose on a $300 stock set or $200 whatever it cost me, mess it up. So I had someone else do it for me. Turned out pretty decent. Wish the Tiger striping turned out a little bit more. This light really doesn't do it a whole lot of justice, but you get the feel of it. These guns were imported for a short amount of time, back in the early 2000s, I think, or somewhere around there. Century recently had a re-release of these, and it was a very small re-release, and I was able to snatch another one up. Typically on the collector market, you'll pay close to $1,000. If you get all the accessories, it's new in box and pristine condition, you may pay upwards of $1,500, depending on the number of magazines and, again, accessories that you get with it. When Century was selling them in their last run, which was, I think, last year, the MSRP for the rifle, the scope, and four magazines was $850, which is what I paid. So there are deals out there to be had. You really just got to watch for them. Keep your eyes on, you know, the forums and things of that nature, and you'll come across really cool deals. But I looked for this particular rifle for a very long time. Finally found one on the private market, overpaid for it, and as you can see, upgraded the stock and the handguards. Really enjoy it. When I had the opportunity to buy the second one, which I did from Century, I jumped on it, obviously, for the $850. It was a steal. It did come with four magazines and a scope. I didn't pull the scope out because you just saw it in the last one. But starting from the front again, you have the muzzle brake. This one doesn't have a bayonet lug. This is the standard handguard set that comes with it. As you can see, kind of a bleach type wood. Thick RPK style receiver. This one's designated the PSL-54C because it is coming directly from Century, not TGI. And then that's the standard stock set that you'll find on these Romanian PSLs. Should have mentioned before, obviously, the PSL is comes from Romania in the Cugir factory. You'll see a lot of these in the conflicts that we have over in Afghanistan and Iraq and Syria and all those places. A lot of the rebels and jihadists or whatever they are, they like to use these guns. So you'll see a lot of these on the news. Really fun gun. I bought this particular one, just kind of a hold on to collector, probably sell it down the line if I ever get into a pinch for money. In the meantime, I'm enjoying it, keeping it clean, more of a safe queen. And that's pretty much it, guys. That is the collection. Like I said, I kind of ran out of room, so I'm not sure how much more firearms I'm going to be able to get until I get a new safe, but this is a pretty sizable collection in my opinion. I really don't need many more rifles than this. You certainly get to a point where it kind of looks like you've got a compulsion issue, so that's probably the point where I'm at now. I need to probably stop or get some help on it, but I tell you what, collecting these rifles is a lot of fun. There's so many different variants out there. It's not like an AR-15 where there's a million different manufacturers and everyone and their grandfather has one. You know, AKs is on the U.S. market a little bit more unknown. It's you know, a growing population of people out there who really enjoy collecting and shooting AKs, and I am definitely one of those people. This is the platform has caught the love of my heart, and I will certainly continue to watch out for treasures out there. Some things on my radar are some Chinese rifles like the Type 56S and some other things such as those that, you know, if you ever find in a gun store or on a private list, you definitely want to jump on and just, you know, get a hold of it. And that's probably where the end of my rest of my retirement fund will be going. So I hope you guys enjoyed. If you have any questions, feel free to let me know. Otherwise, this is the gun collection for 2014. I look forward to seeing what 2015 brings. I appreciate everyone's support. And until next time, guys, take her easy.